The most unique facility in American motorsports, the Dover International Speedway, built with a horse racing track inside it, a casino alongside it, and banking on the track itself that makes it difficult and demanding on both car and driver. 200 miles ahead for the NASCAR Nationwide Series today on the Monster Mile, the command to start engines just a short time away. I'm Alan Bestwick. Welcome to our coverage from Dover. 12 of the last 13 times the Nationwide Series has raced on the Monster Mile, it's been a Sprint Cup driver taking home the trophy. But only two of those Cup drivers are entered in this race. It's a great chance for one of these young drivers to steal some spotlight by taking home a very hard-earned trophy. To reset the top stories of today's race, we go to Pit Road and Shannon Spake.
Well, Alan, last week it took the 6 team just 13 minutes to fix the broken drive shaft and get Ricky Stenhouse Jr., your points leader, back out onto the racetrack. And sure, Mike Kelly said that they lost 21 points because of where they finished. But he said the main key is the fact that they gained 7 points by getting back out onto that racetrack and finishing the race. He spoke to his guys today. He told them they did a great job. They could always do better, and they will be certainly ready for anything that comes their way today. Alan?
All right, Shannon, thanks. So that the lead story where the championship is concerned as we get ready to go 200 miles in Dover. First, trackside for the opening ceremony.
Race fans, please rise and remain standing. Presenting today's national colors are the Dover Air Force Base Honor Guard. And delivering today's invocation from Dover Air Force Base, the Air Force Base Chaplain, Captain Josh Rumsey.
Heavenly Father, I pray for the safety of everyone here today, both competitors and spectators. May we have the strength to compete to the best of our ability, the courage to confront misbehavior, and the perspective to remember what matters most in the end. Remind us, a good name is better than great wealth or even winning. It's in the most precious and holy name of God's only Son that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Here to perform our national anthem, please welcome Ashley Forrest, who just released her new single, Eyes Wide Open.
Oh, see, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner
So we're getting ready to race in Dover, a community with a big military tradition. Dover Air Force Base just up the street providing that flyover. Dover also a community with a big racing tradition. And the 57th NASCAR Nationwide Series race in Delaware's capital city is about to begin. Delaware, the first state, first to ratify the Constitution of the United States. Today, someone's going to be first. The first NASCAR Nationwide Series driver to the checkered flag after 200 miles on the Monster Mile. Engines will fire up shortly here in Dover. Hall of Famer and three-time Dover winner Rusty Wallace has made the move up to the broadcast booth to join myself and three-time Dover winner and champion crew chief Andy Petrie. This racetrack is rough, it's tough, And yet, Rusty, a lot of drivers will tell you it's one of their favorites. Why?
It's a lot of fun, number one. You get to attack this racetrack. A lot of tracks have problems with design flaws, stuff like that. Not this track. It's really straightforward. In order to run fast here, you got to get up on a wheel and drive hard. And drivers like that. They just love being able to attack this track, run this concrete. Andy, this is one of the most favorite places I ever ran at, and those are the reasons why.
Yeah, but it's one of these tracks that you get in trouble really quick. There's a lot of rookies in this field, and also there's not very many former winners in this field as well. So somebody's going to have a good chance to get that first win, but also think that you're going to see some more cautions and potential problems on the track, because when you do make a mistake, even a small mistake here can turn into a big mistake because the track is so narrow, nowhere to go if somebody gets in trouble.
So just two drivers in the top 35 in Sprint Cup points in this field. They are Joey Logano and Kurt Busch. Touched on this briefly downstairs. I'm going to flush it out a little bit more here. If I can have you pick Logano and Busch or one of the other 41 in the field to win today, who's it going to be?
I'm going to pick Joey Logano. He's a young guy, but he's run good here before. Logano's the guy I'm picking.
I like the numbers, man. I'm taking the field, but the number I like in the field are the two up top, the two numbers up top, the two and the six with Elliott Sadler and Ricky Stenhouse.
Guys, both who have some wins already this season and a chance to get another one here at the Monster Mile today. What makes this track different from the others? The transition from straightaway into corner and from corner back onto straightaway. There's no other track on the circuit where the cars, when you're standing on pit road, are above your head on the racetrack, and then the driver drops down off that hill into the corner. It's so punishing to the car and to the driver.
A lot of elevation changes, like you just said. Add to that, this is a solid concrete racetrack. Some drivers like it, some hate it. I personally liked it, but it's got a lot of different feel than other tracks because of all those transitions. When you go down to turn one, Alan, it's like you're falling off a cliff. You bomb down to that turn one, you don't have that feel anywhere else.
And the track narrows up off these corners. The corners are pretty wide, but it narrows up so much on the straightaway, and there's limited vision there. And then, like you said, there's big G forces in the corner, not just to the side, but also down in the seat. A lot of positive Gs.
It's a tough place all around. It's a tough place for 200 miles, let alone the 400 the Sprint Cup Series will run tomorrow. And for these drivers climbing behind the wheel, a couple of unknowns that will factor into their day. Slightly different tire that Goodyear has brought here. More on that in just a minute. And track conditions that have changed. All the practice for the Nationwide Series was held yesterday. These drivers had two laps on the track today. There are two laps of qualifying earlier. Since then, the Sprint Cup cars have been out and qualified. The rubber conditions on this concrete surface are a little bit different. And we'll see how it all plays into the inside lane, outside lane, side-by-side start when they wave the green flag. Before they can turn them loose under that green flag, we need to hear some very important words.
And now to set today's field into motion, I present to you Risa McGuire, Vice President of Sales for 5-Hour Energy, and Chad Clark, Director of Sports Marketing for 5-Hour Energy.
Drivers, are you ready to kick this monster's butt? If so, fire your engines!
Crank it up.
A little premature there. That's okay. We're all good.
Yeah, it's 40. We're 41. Ready to go.
We're good.
Crank it up. Is that between you and the 11, the 14?
Good to hear.
Yes.
Done with some energy, for sure. And the engines have fired here at the Monster Mile. Fans, remember to check out Race Buddy. Enhanced coverage for select Nationwide Series races with more cameras than ever. Log on to NASCARNationwideseries.com/RaceBuddy. When the field rolls off in a minute, we're going to talk to our ESPN in-race reporter for the day. He is the Illinois native Justin Allgaier, a two-time winner in the Nationwide Series, sixth in the championship starting today. He starts seventh, and he talks with us next.
The Dover International Speedway, NASCAR's one-mile high-speed, high-banked white nightmare.
Oh, the car's upside down.
Every lap presents an opportunity to make a big move. But every corner presents another chance for disaster.
He drove straight across the damn racetrack.
So fire those engines and proceed with caution.
Whoa, whoa, look out.
It's time to unleash the monster.
The question is, on which driver or drivers will the monster unleash its wrath on? as the NASCAR Nationwide Series rolls out onto the Monster Mile for 200 laps on this very difficult racetrack. If I added right, Andy, 200 laps on a one-mile track is...
Hey, that's good, Al.
Yeah, 200 miles.
That's sharp.
Very slow pit road speed, 35 miles an hour. Four sets of tires for the teams to change today. They won't use them all. More on that in a minute. And as you look at the width of this racetrack, just 48 feet on the straightaways, doesn't offer a lot of room with that inside wall there if you get in trouble.
I tell you what, you get trouble, you go down, you hit that inside wall, and you fly back up and hit the outside wall. It's like playing on a pinball machine. You get beat up pretty bad there.
Except you don't get any bonus points for opening the gate. All right, our ESPN in-race reporter today is Justin Allgaier, two-time winner on the NASCAR Nationwide Series, who'd love to get back to victory lane today.
Justin, Rusty Wallace up in the ESPN booth. You got us?
Second gear.
Hey, Justin, Rusty up here in the ESPN booth. You got us?
Loud and clear, Rusty. Go ahead.
Okay, we've got an ESPN mailbag question. It comes from Savannah in Richmond, Virginia. The question is, as challenging as this track is, why is it so favored to most all the drivers?
Say that again there, Rusty. You broke up on me, bud.
As challenging as this track is, why is it a favorite for so many drivers?
I think that's an easy question there. This racetrack's just so fast and has so much speed to it. You drive into these corners, and the sensation of dropping in to turn one here is just amazing. So hopefully we got our Brandt Chevy primed up. That was one of the things we worked on yesterday was corner entry. It's going to be slick today, and should be a good race.
All right, buddy. Well, you had practice the other day, and your car looked pretty good in practice. But since then, we've had a lot of rain, and this track is awful green right now. You got any concerns about how your car is going to handle early in the going?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, the track has obviously got a lot less rubber on it, and it's hotter than it was when we practiced yesterday. So, we're going to use this first run before the competition caution to get everything fueled out, make sure that we're where we want to be at. But like you said, the car was really, really good the other day, and I feel like we got a Brandt Chevy that could possibly get in the victory lane today.
All right, buddy, thanks for talking to us, and have a great race. Now Andy's going to speak to your crew chief, Jimmy Ellich.
Thank you.
Hey, Jimmy, Andy Petrie up here in the booth. The consensus has been the track's really going to change as this race goes on. Which way do you expect it to go for your car, and how do you expect to, or what kind of changes do you expect to make to compensate?
Yeah, with the rain washing the rubber away, I do think that it's going to be a little bit free here in the beginning, until the thing rubbers up. And then after that competition yellow, I think you can start to get a read on what the racetrack is going to be like. And I think we're going to probably have to free it up as the day goes on, as the rubber gets into it. But, watching the truck race last night, our trucks seemed to, all the Turner trucks seemed to get a little bit freer as it got rubber. So we'll just have to wait and see, be ready to go either way.
All right, man, turn those screws the right way. Good luck. Thanks for talking to us.
And Justin Allgaier's front tire carrier, Matt Holzbauer from New Egypt, New Jersey. I guess this be his home track, too, is going to carry our over-the-wall camera today. Matt, good luck. Have a safe race.
Thanks.
Look at the high-definition onboard cameras to help us with our Dover broadcast today. Austin Dillon with the American Ethanol camera. Ricky Stenhouse Jr., the Ford EcoBoost onboard. Danica Patrick's GoDaddy.com camera. Sam Hornets Jr., the Dodge onboard. Ryan Truex, the Nationwide Insurance camera. Justin Allgaier with the Goodyear onboard. It is Ty Dillon with the Chevy on board, and Cole Witt, the clean Cole on board. Cole dropping to the back of the field from 19th spot on approved adjustments. From pit road before the green, Dave Burns.
Alan, can Ryan Truex win at a track called the Monster just 11 days after emergency appendectomy? He starts on pole today. Mike Massaro.
Danica Patrick's lasted only time here at the Monster Mile in a Nationwide car was September 2010. More than a year and a half ago, she spent the entire weekend relearning the racetrack. She set modest goals for today, saying a top 15 finish would be successful, Ellen.
All right, thanks. Competition caution coming at lap 40 because of the overnight rain. New tire that Goodyear has brought here. We'll talk about that as the race gets underway. But first, coming to the green, Ryan Truex, Joey Logano, the Joe Gibbs Racing teammates, bring the field down for the start. lap one.
Looks like Ryan Truex got a pretty good start right through Allen, but Logano was on his game, and he really needed to get in front of Logano a little bit farther than he did getting down to turn one. That outside lane took over, and Logano is just checking out right now.
Yeah, it looked like he might get clear, Logano, but not quite, and Logano took advantage of it.
Stenhouse to second. Ryan Truex to third, side by side for fourth. Two, Elliott Sadler, 33, Ty Dillon.
A pair of teammates right there side by side right now. Pretty new run here for Dillon. He gets into wall just a little bit, guys.
Well, that turn two wall will jump up and bite you, won't it, Rusty?
It will, Andy. When you get on the outside, there's not much grip up there. You're carrying a lot of speed at this racetrack, and you've got to be wide open in the center of this corner. You're going to run fast.
08 car, caution out.
Come on down. We hit the fence.
Tim Andrews looking like he's got a lot of damage on the right side of that
hard
car.
Hard lick. This track is so unforgiving.
See, that right front tire is already flat in that car. I don't know if that happened when he hit the wall or that's what's caused him to hit the wall.
All right, first caution out. Just four laps into the race. Look at a couple things here.
Yeah, Ty Dillon just carrying a little extra speed, and the track's not quite cleaned off up top. Not much contact, though.
And now the 08 of Tim Andrews.
Yeah, he's got a problem getting in the corner already. It looked like the right front went down.
Yeah, that right front air dam was laying on the ground, entering a corner, so I'd say I already blew that right front tire, and he getting in the wall. It wasn't his fault.
Yeah, and as early as it was in the run, you got to think it was something on the car rubbing that tire or ran over something. Tough break either way.
You know, you just wonder a little bit, at least I do, when Ty got in that wall off the corner, did he lay any debris down? And look at him, he's so frustrated, Tim is. He wanted this race so bad.
Yeah, just to be sitting four laps in already out, that's got to be frustrating.
He's a young driver with a lot of talent, and he just needs to showcase his talent, and he can't do it now. He's in the garage area.
Caution out early in the going. In Dover in the 5-Hour Energy 200. Back at the 5-Hour Energy 200 at Dover. Make sure to go to NASCAR.com for all your latest NASCAR information. Information I'll give you here is that Joey Logano has chosen the outside lane for the restart with Ricky Stenhouse Jr. to his inside.
Well, I'm not going to say that Logano jumped the restart, but he did a good job getting through the gearbox.
Yeah, he got a good start.
And if there's any question whether starting on the outside was the right thing to do or wrong thing to do, he fixed it by getting through that gearbox into turn one first.
Second spot, Ty Dillon, 33, working on Stenhouse in the 6, and there's Kurt Busch in the 54.
We talked about Kurt Busch early in our broadcast and countdown about how bad these brothers want to make this new team run. This is a track that Kurt really likes. He's won the cup race here last year. This particular race, he's being aggressive right now early in this race.
Yeah, especially around a couple of rookie drivers, not a lot of experience. Kurt's not afraid to mix it up with them, though.
It's for fourth place. Ryan Truex on the outside.
They're not afraid to mix it up with him either, are they?
No, they're not, I'll tell you. It's pretty early in the race right now, only 10 laps into this thing. The good thing these drivers got coming for them is lap 40, that competition caution because of all the rain. So if there's some cars not handling good right now, Andy, at least they can come in and get them tuned up then.
Yeah, that's a good thing, and you can run the car hard. You know you're going to only run 40 laps. You can run it hard, not worry about tire wear, really expose any issues you might have with your car so you can get those adjustments made during that stop.
Top two have separated themselves from this group racing for third.
You know, there's one driver I'm taking. Yeah, 54 in the wall a bit. Started to say one driver I really want to see how she does is Danica Patrick at this racetrack. We talked earlier how this is a very, very physically demanded racetrack. The exits turn two and four are hard to drive. How can Danica do today, Andy? That's what I'm looking at.
Well, she's hanging in there. She's just ahead of Michael Annette in that 43 car.
Yeah.
See, she's struggling just a little bit up off the corner. Allows Annette to get the inside groove on the seventh car for position.
I talked to a lot of the IndyCar drivers that she used to compete against. They told me that Rusty, when her car is not right, she tends to slow down a little bit. This lady very seldom crashes just all by herself. If the car is not handling, she'll work on it. And I've been seeing her do this a lot, especially at Darlington, South Carolina about 3 weeks ago when she had a great run, finished 12th over there. And she's been proving a lot of people wrong about how long it would take her to get going. Prove me wrong.
That is a busy steering wheel inside that car.
You can see just how physically demanding it is. I mean, she's having to really wrestle that car.
Our in-race reporter, Justin Allgaier, running for ninth spot there with Brian Scott in the 11. Scott has high hopes for this race today. We documented in Countdown the rough season that he's had so far, but he has a win in the NASCAR Camping World Truck Series at this track, considers it one of his best.
You know, it's on his mind, the problems he's had this year, all the crashing. In fact, he told us in Countdown that he went and actually talked to Ricky Stenhouse, and Ricky said, hey, look, man, I didn't really change anything. I just kind of got it out of my system because, what was it, like 20 races? Ricky wrecked like maybe 15 times or something crazy like that?
Well, he may not have changed anything, but he learned a lot. Yeah. I'll tell you, he learned a lot through all that. That experience has really paid off. And I don't think he slowed down. I think that's what he's saying. He didn't slow down and make an adjustment. I think he just learned how to control the car a little better in different situations.
How impressive is it that Ty Dillon, in his first ever drive in a Nationwide Series car, and he's the ARCA Series champion. He's got experience on this racetrack in the Camping World Truck Series. Ran yesterday, but how impressive is it that he's up here running in third spot, even just in the early going?
And this is a tough racetrack. You come to a track for your first Nationwide race, you come to Dover, qualify third, and here he is running in the top six.
It's good stuff. He and Ryan Truex racing for a spot there, Doc.
Indeed they are, trying to hold off Truex. Now the 33 driver, Ty Dillon, getting a lot of input from his spotter, telling him, hey, you're off in the corner too much. Go straight in, dive straight in. You don't want to open up the door. So what he's trying to do is teach him lap by lap here, from the early lap, not to open the door, Rusty, going in the corner so you don't let the 20 car have a shot to get under him.
Yeah, early in the run here, you don't want to do anything wrong and wreck yourself, but you don't want to open the door like they're saying and let somebody drive underneath you. They do have this caution coming to lap 40, so keep himself up in the front. Don't get caught on the bottom, because here at this track, Jerry, you can get freight trained, we call it. You can get stuck in the top lane, or they'll drive right past you on the bottom. You don't want that to happen.
Big run for Truex there off of turn two.
One thing he's got to be careful of, though, if you're holding up a bunch of cars behind you, they're going to get impatient and move you. You don't want that to happen. You can see now Ty's giving the bottom lane up, and he's still maintaining speed.
Let's see if the 54 just follows the 20 car right through, because that's what generally happens, guys.
Oh, that's going to get tight with that left car.
No, did it the other way, run outside.
Yeah, Truex, big loser on that exchange.
Caught the traffic at the wrong time and picked the wrong way to try and go around him. So Truex falls back to fifth, Kurt Busch to fourth, working on Ty Dillon for third. All this going on behind Joey Logano, who says Dover is, quote, one of my favorite tracks to run. I'm a huge fan of this track. He's led all the laps in this one so far. Back at Dover, caution out, huge story. Championship leader Ricky Stenhouse Jr. has crashed on the back straightaway and heavily damaged that Ford. He was running second at the time. Yellow flag out just 27 laps into the event.
Boy, this track can humble you in a heartbeat. Like I said, little mistakes, you just don't get away with them much here. It just gets loose, gets out from under him, and when that happens, there's nowhere to go. You're going to hit something.
You ride along with him here, he just gets loose. It's a classic case to get loose on the exit of the corners here, and then bank straightaway puts you right into the inside wall like that.
Yellow's out.
But guys, I would have never dreamed a mistake would have been made like that out of a guy like Ricky Stenhouse, our last year's champion. He's been bullet fast.
That's not the guy I thought would have a problem. No. We see so many more drivers in this field with less experience. But it just shows you this track doesn't play favorites.
So now this team will do all they can to get this car repaired and back out on the racetrack if they can, and try and salvage some points like they did a week ago in Charlotte. Some pit stops. Matt Holzbauer carrying tires for Justin Allgaier.
you don't see is anybody putting fuel in. It's not allowed until that competition caution.
So Allgaier will head back out. Caution out, second time in the race. Somewhat of a shocking development as the championship leader running second gets the wall hard on the Monster Mile.
And no contest right there. Logano just got such a huge run. Look at Kurt Busch get loose in the middle of the corner.
You see Logano for his third time in a row now get to this gearbox better than anybody out there. I used to say that Kyle Busch was the very best driver in an 18 car. Maybe it's something about that 18 car. I don't know. Oh, he's got great restarts.
So Logano holds the lead while you watch some of the action on the track and after the restart. Ricky Stenhouse Jr. has come from the medical center, Mike.
Yeah, he has emerged from the care center and is anxious to get back to his race car. But first, we got to ask you, what happened?
Driver made a mistake. Just running around there until a competition caution. Just probably, wasn't up on the wheel as much as I should have been. Just kind of riding around. Just car stepped out from under me, and I got behind on the steering. So I just hate it for all these guys. They work really hard. We changed a lot in practice and definitely made the car better. We just wish we could perform a little bit better for the Cargill guys. But we'll be back. Got off weekend next weekend, and we'll get him at Michigan.
Thank you, Ricky.
Thank you.
As you might imagine, Alan, he's very anxious to complete his media duties, go back and see whether or not they can get that car back in the race.
Rusty, one thing that people probably don't really understand is how quickly these cars will jump out from under you once they lose just a little bit of traction.
Especially at this racetrack because of the transitions to the corners, Andy. I mean, and another thing to add, this is concrete and not asphalt racetrack. And a lot of drivers will tell you that there's not as much grip on the concrete in their opinion. I tend to like it. A lot of people don't. But boy, that thing stepped out just a little bit. And when it gets loose, there's only one way to go. That's down the hill into the inside wall. You don't get a freebie like at some other racetracks, like maybe Michigan or Charlotte, where the back straight is real wide.
Off the pace, Mike Bliss, who had slipped back in the first couple laps of the race, got way wide in 3 and 4 and lost a number of spots. And now he is slowing from 11th position. And we'll see what's up with the 44 car. Just a few laps till the competition caution that was scheduled for lap 40 by NASCAR. I want to just follow up with something on that Stenhouse story. I had a conversation here in the garage with him on Friday. And while you watch this, this is Ty Dillon and Brian Scott here racing for 6th and 7th. Stenhouse told me I have to drive 100% all the time. He said, when I get a big lead and they want me to back off, he said, I back off and the lap times don't suffer any. You know, sometimes go slower to go faster. He said, but I feel like I'm not as sharp. I'm not as sharp in my reflexes. I'm not as sharp in what's going on in my head like I am when I'm going 100%. And I only bring that up because he said there we were just running along to the competition caution and I made a mistake. And, you know, your reaction to that as a driver.
Well, I've experienced that. I've went through that where I've had such big leads. At this racetrack, I've went through this where you got such big leads and you start slowing down and the car doesn't load up in the center of the corner near as much. And all of a sudden, it changes your handling. All of a sudden, it's going to push or get loose. Because if you're running one speed and that's hard, that's what the car wants to do. But if you alter that, sometimes it really screws up the handling of the car, and that's what Ricky's alluding to right there.
There's your competition caution. NASCAR doing like it always does with a planned yellow, letting all of the lead lap cars come through before they throw the caution so they don't alter the scoring in some way. And before the leaders hit the pit lane under this yellow flag, an update on how the repair situation looks on that 6, Mike.
And just as was the case a week ago, all hands on deck here trying to get this 6 car repaired. You can see the hood is up. Lots of damage on the left front corner of this race car. They've got lots of work to do if they hope to get it back in the race, Alan.
And we saw when it hit the wall, the water kind of shoot up from inside it. I wondered if that was the radiator just literally exploding on the car when he hit.
Yeah, I remember having to put a whole complete front frame section on the car during the race here. Crashed early in a 500-lap race.
And Mike Bliss has gone back into the garage area, and that team trying to find out what happened.
Mike came into this race eighth in the championship.
Now, pit road's open. Likely we'll see somebody like Justin Allgaier that pitted under the last caution. Just get fuel and go and maybe get the lead here.
So Logano, Kurt Busch, Ryan Truex, Austin Dillon, Elliott Sadler, the top five coming in. Stops at lap 42. And we go to Shannon.
Alan, Joey Logano, your race leader, he says as rubber continues to build up on the racetrack, it gets freer and freer. They're going to make an air pressure adjustment, track bar, as well as Sunoco fuel. Dave?
The other three cars in your screen are second, third, and fourth place. Austin Dillon just a little free in the center. He'll get adjustments for that. Sunoco fuel. Kurt Busch's car was tied off at the corner. They're gaining on it, though. He'll get a track bar and air pressure adjustment. And the 20 of Ryan Truex are pole sitter. He needs to turn better in the center. Here goes the Grind Boss crew finishing up, and they will not win the race off pit road. There were a few cars out ahead of them, Alan.
There was some strategy played, as Mr. Petrie speculated.
Yeah, you can see this developing under the last caution when saw us, Justin Allgaier and a couple more come in. They got their tires thin. Now they can get fuel and get the lead.
Justin Allgaier will be at the head of the pack when we restart in just a minute.
Nationals.
One, two, three, three!
Well, Miles the Monster has already taken a chomp out of a few at the Monster Mile today, including championship leader Ricky Stenhouse Jr., who's got a beaten-up race car and is back in the garage, still shy of the one-quarter mark of this race. We heard from Stenhouse, Mike Bliss also back in the garage. Michael?
Yeah, and we saw him fall off the pace, Alan, and now we know why. Bliss said he just had no power. They lost a cylinder out there. A tough break for this team that had been inside the top 10 in the standings coming into this afternoon, Alan.
All right, Mike, thanks. So Bliss back in the garage as we get set for the restart. Remember, Justin Allgaier did not take fresh tires on this caution flag. Joey Logano to his inside in the 18 as we restart. Kurt Busch to the inside of Allgaier for second as Logano is back out in front.
Justin Allgaier was pretty upset with Kurt Busch early in this race. Thought that Kurt got into him and turned him sideways. We heard some radio chatter about that early. Let's see what these two do right now. See if they kind of respect each other or not.
I don't think you're going to see Allgaier cut him a break. I don't think he's going to let him go because of that, because Allgaier lost a lot of spots early in the race, and he kind of blamed that on Kurt Busch because he thought he got into him.
Little three wide there. Sam Hornish in the 12 on the move. Around Parker Kligerman in the 22. And Cole Witt in the 88. By the way, that's a nice recovery for this 88 team from starting in the back, playing their strategy and getting up right now to be in the top 10.
Yeah, we watched Cole all year long just really do a good job at Dale Jr.'s 88 car. But the 54 car of Kurt Busch we're looking at right now, we talked earlier about how much better this team's getting. I really did question whether they were way off in horsepower earlier in the year, but it appears to me that their power's coming back, and they're getting better power, they're learning. And that was the one thing I thought this brand-new Kyle Busch team was really suffering from, was power early.
Well, the biggest thing they suffer from is just being a young team, new team. It takes a while to get established. This is a very competitive series. You're not just going to, I don't care if you're Kurt Busch, you're Kyle Busch, you're not going to just jump in here and have it all figured out.
Let's talk about the strategy call by Jimmy Yellage in the 31, Andy. They stopped under the second caution and took tires at lap 28. Then under the competition caution, pit stop at lap 42, just fuel only to go from 11th to the lead. What determined
Kurt Busch in the wall hard,
whether that will be a successful strategy or
back,
not.
Check it out down the front here.
I think it's a successful strategy for them.
And take off.
This is one thing I'm concerned about with Kurt Busch. I mean, guys, I'm just going to put it out here. In my opinion, he keeps overdriving this car. He keeps doing it. We talked to one of the guys from James Finch's team today. Said he has wrecked 14 cars this year. He just got to slow down to go fast.
Yeah, that's basically what happened. He just overdrove. He was in the groove. He just kind of overdrove the car on exit. Dave?
Andy, one of the things things that Kurt's been working on because he has not driven this nationwide car that much is maneuverability. Yesterday in practice, they got the balance fairly good, but then they spent a lot of time just getting it to where Kurt could hustle the car, maneuver it in traffic. He just hasn't had a lot of laps in this type of race car.
Well, the other thing is, too, that the expectations are very high for these, both of these Busch brothers to run well and win races, and they feel it. But they may be pushing too hard, more than the car really has, until they get this car developed to the level of the Joe Gibbs cars and the Childress cars. They may not have a car that's capable of doing what they're used to, and that's winning.
Yes. You don't want to overdrive the car. You don't want to. You try to make it go fast, but you don't try to take a car that has the points of fourth or fifth place car and make it a first place car, or else you're going to get in a wall. Things like that are going to happen with them.
Four top 10 spots, 88 Cole Witt, 22 Parker Kligerman today in the Penske car, one of the Penske cars, and right behind them, Elliott Sadler, the championship leader now in the two.
And you got to believe that Elliott Sadler knows everything that's going on right now with Ricky Stenhouse, and he's thinking, we got to gain some points today, guys. We can't crash our own car or have bad pit stops or maybe get a pit road speeding penalty, something like that.
Yeah, I'm worried, though, Rusty. We gave you two cars, and I took the field. Your guy's out there gone, 1.6 seconds ahead.
I didn't even think about that.
I tell you, watching this two-car, he, in the first run of the race, got way wide in three and four one time and looked like he had his hands full. And now he's back there outside the top 10.
Yeah, I mean, he's struggling a little bit. I didn't expect this because I watched him in practice, and they were extremely happy. They were making little changes, and everything was doing exactly what they thought it would do. Talked to Luke Lambert at length this morning, and they felt very confident they were going to be good enough to win. I don't know why that they're not any better than they are. Have you got anything more, Dave, on this two team?
And he just wanted to give you Elliott's report. Early in the run before they pitted, he was free to where the car compresses and then sliding the front tires late. And then, as the pit stops approached, his car was harder to turn from the center off the corner. Now, they made a track bar and air pressure adjustment on the stop, but he may still be struggling with it.
I'm telling you what, when you got a race car that lands and it's loose getting in, yet plows the front end, pushing the front on exit, that's a hard thing to fix.
Yeah, it is, but that's one of the things when I talked to Luke this morning that they expected to have to maybe adjust for is loose in and tie it off. I don't think they thought it would be this bad, though.
Cornish 12. Buescher 30.
Pike. Those two right there got together a little bit.
Eighth place just changed hands. And Cole Witt trying to get a piece of that action as well. A little past quarter distance today in the 5-Hour Energy 200 for the NASCAR Nationwide Series at the Monster Mile. Joey Logano has been monster fast so far. Here comes the six. Stenhouse Jr. coming back onto the track. 66 laps down to the race leader and currently showing in 33rd spot.
The thing now is the team hopes they didn't shortcut any of the repairs so they have to come back and fix it again. They've got a lot of stuff on that car that's just kind of hanging and dangling. You don't want anything falling off of it.
I'll tell you, the toughest thing is to go out with a car like he's got right now with no nose on it, and the only thing sticking out there is the radiator. And if you get on a restart a little too close to somebody in front of you, you bump them. The only thing you're going to bump is that radiator, then you're completely out of the race.
These two young guys are having a fun fight.
I'm impressed with Ty able to find to search around this racetrack and find something that works for him. This is working. He's able to make that pass on Kligerman.
And when you find something that's working for you like that, you want to use it the rest of the race. But I tell you, one thing I just saw then, Andy, he took that right side tires and put it up so high, he was almost out of the groove. If that happens, you're going to slide up the track, pick up all that rubber, and lose everything you just gained.
Yeah, he's making it work, though. You can tell he's gained quite a bit of distance now on Kligerman.
Speaking of young guys, the young guy that started on pole for today's race, Ryan Truex in the Joe Gibbs Racing 20. He is running fourth.
And I'm out of control. Can't even drive it up high.
So here's a guy can't even drive his car up high.
Well, you know, one thing he needs to realize, if he was looking at the times that we're looking at right now, that last time by, he was probably the third quickest guy in the racetrack.
Was Ty Dillon.
With Ryan Truex.
Yep.
And Ryan said he was so loose.
He had that steering wheel turned left hand over right hand last corner.
Starting to free up again. It's like if I try to run hard, I lose my right rear and I gotta let it cool down.
Well, you're right, Rusty. Look at the lap time. The last lap, while we're watching this, he was the fastest car on the track.
Yeah, and my point is that you've seen this 1,000 times too. You might think your car is really bad, but in comparison to everybody else, you're not as bad as you think you are.
It might feel bad, but it's actually running pretty good.
Right, exactly right.
That's what the team needs to be telling him. They say, hey, look, you're fast. The times are great. I know the car's loose, but just take care of it and make time with it.
Coming to the halfway point of today's NASCAR Nationwide Series race in Dover. The first half of this one so far highlighted by Joey Logano leading all but three laps. Logano continuing to set a very blistering pace here at the Monster Mile. Joey Logano has got it going on at Dover today. In the NASCAR Nationwide Series 200-miler, Joey has led 104 of 107 laps so far, continuing a trend at this racetrack where guys find that feel and that setup, and they tend to dominate a race.
I tell you, there's a lot of drivers that got favorite racetracks, and this is absolutely one of Joey's. I mean, I had Bristol, where I won 9 times, and Martinsville, and Richmond, and places like that. You can tell Joey is in that zone, too, in a style rift. And this is definitely one of his favorite tracks.
Justin Allgaier running second, 3.1 seconds behind Logano. They pulled a little strategy earlier to gain some track position. There's Kurt Busch running third, despite scuffing the right side of that car on the wall a little while back. And fourth is Ryan Truex. We go up to speed with Nationwide Insurance. Check in on some of these guys chasing the top three. Dave?
Well, and Ryan Truex said most of it himself, that the car is out of control. It's really not been to his liking most of the day. And here we all wondered if he was going to be in pain from his appendectomy 11 days ago. His car's been the pain today, even though it's fast. The three of Austin Dillon has been very good the whole weekend. Crew Chief Danny Sockman told me, I haven't seen Austin this happy about a race car since the truck days. So far today, just a little bit loose. Mike?
It's been a rough season for Brian Scott. Last week, crashing out of Charlotte marked his fifth DNF of the year. He said he took the wind out of the team. They could certainly use a good run. They're getting it today. They're running sixth, although he says he's losing rear grip as this run goes on.
Mike, the two of Elliott Sadler may be among the first cars to pit under green flag stops. He may have to take a little more time on pit road than others to remove a spring rubber from the right rear of the car. This car right now will not run well. It is tight on landing to exit, and that or actually loose, and that taking that spring rubber out would help it. Doc?
Michael Annette started back in 23rd, guys, and he pitted on lap 28 for 4 tires, came back in on the competition yellow for fuel only. That's what got him the track position. But right now he says that the car has no brakes. The brake pedal is down and will not come back. Also very loose on entry. Shannon.
Well, Sam Hornish Jr. said Dover, it's a track he just loves coming to. However, the love was very lost this weekend. He said he was really disappointed in practice. The car was way too loose. It has been decent in this race, however. Really, the only area he's struggling in is through turn. He says he can't make the pass in that area. Doc?
Cole went. The crew left the cowl cover on during qualifying, which crushed the air filter. They had to change the air filter after qualifying, which meant he had to go to the back of the pack in 41st. Fuel only on the competition yellow, and he now has gone all the way up to run in the top 10 in 10th position. Guys?
Well, that's tough right there. That little cover they put over the cowl opening at the base of the windshield, and they evidently forgot to take it off when he qualified.
And that's how the engine gets all of its air, so starved for horsepower. And Cole Whitt running a lap down and losing a couple of spots with those he's racing with as James Buescher and Ty Dillon go by in the 33 and the 30. Now, coming up on green flag pit stops momentarily. In fact, here's second place Justin Allgaier dropping down off the banking, and he'll be the first one to come to pit road. Now, the pit road speed here at Dover is 35 miles an hour. It's a long pit road. It's a curved pit road at the beginning there. And this pit road also has a very short speed trap at the end of it. This racetrack has produced more speeding penalties on pit road than any other track that has two races over the last several years. Here he comes, Dave.
the car for Justin Lately, when he gets to the center of the corner, the landing part, it won't turn. So there will be a track bar adjustment to help that out. Four tires and full of Sunoco fuel. Great strategy played so far for the 31 today.
88 on pit road, and they're having some issues as well. The cars are just loose out of the gas, tight under throttle. They're going to make an adjustment, air pressure adjustment. This would be the final pit stop of the race. If we go green, they can stretch the fuel, although it's going to be very close. They would not have enough for a green-white checker. Mike.
Parker Kligerman has been complaining a little bit that the car's been loose all the way around. The team going to work right now on the 22 car, expecting a four-tire change and fuel, also a slight air pressure adjustment on the 22, Doc.
Ty Dillon, four tires, are going to fill it up with Sunoco fuel. No adjustment, a change, that slight air pressure adjustment, rear tire. Otherwise, one eventual stop, he's down and away. Dave.
Kurt Busch has had quite an adventure. He tapped the wall a little bit. The car has been a little bit tight. And then a little bit loose. Right now, the looseness they're going to take care of by putting a spring rubber in the left rear of the car. Four tires, Sunoco fuel. Shannon?
Hey, guys, Sam Hornish Jr. started this race 10th, running in the top 10. Says he's still on the tight side, so they're going to go to work with air pressure on that number 12 car you see on the left-hand side of your screen. They're also going to put four tires and fuel for Sam Hornish Jr. Dave?
Elliott Sadler had been running in the seventh position, had picked up a few spots. He had no lateral grip off the wall or when the car landed in the middle of the corner. They're going to take a spring rubber out of the right rear. As soon as the tire changer takes it off, he'll pop that out, take just a second right there, and then they'll put the tire back on. He will take four tires on this pit stop. Austin Dillon is also on and off of pit road in the three car, guys.
It's a beautiful thing when your car is not only the fastest on the track and handling well, but it's also getting better mileage than everyone, too. Joey Logano still out on the racetrack, not yet having made the move to pit road.
Yeah, he should be able to make it now from here to the end of the race.
Well, this time.
He's got the fastest car. He's got the best mileage at the moment. And generally, his pit crew is probably the best on pit road. So I'm interested to see how this pit stop happens.
It'll be quick.
How quick they are.
All right, tricky pit road entry here at Dover.
Backer down.
Danica Patrick just ahead of Logano on the pit entry here. So Joey gives up the lead momentarily. Momentarily. And while he works his way down to his stall, Mike.
Danica Patrick has been struggling with a loose condition. Not necessarily comfortable being loose here, although her crew chief Tony Urie suggested very much at the beginning of the weekend she needs to be in order to be successful. She's been complaining she's been loose in and off a four-tire change on the 7, Jim.
Joey Logano, your race leader, is in. The crew told him be very careful on this pit stop making your way down pit road. We have a huge lead. A little bit of air pressure and four tires for Joey Logano, and they're holding on fuel, and he's down and away.
And that's 14.7, and they held the car a couple of seconds for that extra fuel just to make sure they get it completely full. I know they can make it to the end if we go green.
I like how they told them, hey, you got a big lead, don't mess up.
Well, that's the point, right?
Drivers need to hear that. Drivers get jacked up on the racetrack. They don't need to go out there and mess up what they've been working on all day long.
So Allgaier running second, and you saw that Logano came up on the racetrack well ahead of him.
Uh-oh.
Oh, trouble! Timmy Hill, 41, gets nudged into the inside wall, and the caution's out.
Directed here. Hold down. Hold the bottom. How bad is it?
It's pretty bad.
It's pretty bad on the front.
He called that one out.
Well,
it's hard to wreck one easy at Dover.
Right front's pretty killed, man.
Been watching some of these groups of cars that are not on the lead lap, racing for position. And it's been pretty intense. And then some of the cars racing for position among the leaders came up into them, and there were just too many cars racing hard in too small a space.
That was pretty obvious, wasn't it? These guys are really getting after it. Let's take a replay. Let's take a look and see what happens here.
Elliott Sadler just gets by before this happens, and this is where I've seen Elliott in the middle of some of these predicaments like you've been talking about, Alan, where these cars have been racing each other extremely hard.
It looks like Timmy Hill got three wide, really didn't mean to get three wide. When he got down there, there was nothing else to do. Let's take a look again here. He's in the center, gets loose.
And Joey Gase in the 52 there that he was trying, it looked like, to stay off of and cut inside, and Sam Hornish was already to his inside in the 12.
got a piece of that. See, Ty Dillon got away.
To see Joey, the leader, just gets through. 2 and 12 are racing for a spot there.
Yeah, I think the deal is that the lap cars were trying to race each other, and these leaders came by a lot quicker and got up on them before they really realized the situation.
We talked about how tough the exit of these corners are, and that's exactly where it happened. There's not much grip up there when the banking starts flattening out as it exits the corner. That's where these cars get a little wild, and that's where this one's happened at.
All right, so Timmy Hill out of his car. We'll see what kind of damage Sam Hornish has to the nose of that 12.
The significance here, too, when this caution came out, is that the 2 car is being shown as the first car one lap down.
Hey guys, that's a lot of damage on this 12 car, Andy.
Yeah, he got a pretty good piece of that.
And the right front tire is flat. It looks like it's down on the inner liner.
But you can see, my point is that you see why Elliott Sadler and Sam Hornish were racing so hard in that position. They were trying to be that car in case the caution came out to be that free pass car.
Good point.
And stuff flying out from under the car that's in front of Sam as well.
Yeah, there's pieces of a tire, looks like, coming apart.
It actually looked like Sam's car, the right front tire, was actually towed out, like he's got a steering problem now, too, a tow out. They got to fix that. They got to fix the fender. They got a lot of work to do to that 12 car.
All right. Pit road's open, as you saw. And Sam is not on the lead lap, so he's going to pit a lap earlier than technically allowed in order to get some of that damage worked on.
Yeah, they're going to spend some time down there getting that fixed so they're not worried about track position. Here they come, Shannon.
Hey, yeah, guys, Chad Walter over the radio telling Sam Hornish Jr., come on down, guys, take your time. Take a look at that right side. We're going to put it up. We're going to make the adjustments and the fix on the right side. Replace those tires and see what's making that dropping down so low. You see them pulling out that right side fender right now. They are going to work on the right side, and what I've been hearing over the radio is that they'll then go back out, get back around, and come back down pit road to work on the left side. Alan?
They do have some work to do for Sam Hornish Jr., who came into this race fourth in the Nationwide Series Championship. Be the second one of the top five to have some troubles today. Back at Dover, coming to the restart. There'll be 71 laps to go in this race. Joey Logano has dominated so far, leading all but 3 laps. Elliott Sadler got the free pass on that caution. Sadler is running in 8th position, but he's got a restart at the tail end of the pack by getting the free pass. So he's behind all the lap cars between he and the other lead lappers as we go green. Kurt Busch on Justin Allgaier. And Ryan Truex going to try and take advantage. Nice move. Whoop, wiggle, wobble.
It's like Kurt Busch's car still loose. They put a spring rubber in the left rear under that green flag stock.
Austin Dillon in the 3, trying to get a spot from 31. Justin Allgaier, that's 4th.
Well, the whole time these guys are all racing around. Joey Logano has got that clear track, and he's just checking out right now. By Kurt Busch and Ryan Truex are just running side by side. I tell you, when they run side by side, that really slows the car down big time. I'm looking at the lap times right now. Last time by 6/10 of a second.
Slow. Oh, trouble, Brad Sweet. Danica's got a piece of this one too.
Yeah.
And Elliott Sadler weaves his way
nothing
through.
Coming at you anywhere. Danica spun it, to get it running. Back up. All right, you're good now. Go ahead.
Ooh, big wreck out of Danica Patrick. The right front destroyed in that car.
A lot of parts and pieces being shed there.
Sam Hornish on the bottom here. Gets up into her. last thing I remember between Hornish and Danica, there was no love loss there from previous races.
Yeah, that wreck right there was initiated by Sam Hornish. Gets into the left rear of Danica. She can't do anything but try to chase the car up the hill right into Brad Sweet. See the deck lid tethers doing their job, holding that deck lid attached to the car on Brad Sweet's car.
On board the 7.
12, inside the 12. Clear low. Yes, coming high here. Keep coming high. Go low, low on the side. Clear low.
And from Hornish.
Two outside. One outside.
You can hear Sam pedaling the car.
Yes. You know, we've talked all day long about how tough it is to exit these corners, how tight they get. I just can't emphasize enough how turn four, you know, after these restarts is just a tough, tough corner. You try to make a pass, you see an opening, you go for it, and things like this happen.
Pit stops, second and third place have come in. The leader stayed out. Dave?
Neither one particularly happy with their race cars right now. Both will get adjustments. It's loose from the center off for the 54. That'll be a wedge adjustment for Kurt Busch. As for the 31 of Justin Allgaier, they did get his car from tight to loose. Now it's way too loose. So they're going to go back just a little bit on those adjustments. Four fresh tires, fuel to the end.
All right, well, with just 8 cars on the lead lap, not giving up a whole lot to come in and adjust it if it's not right.
Yeah, not a bad move by either one of these cars because they weren't good enough to win.
So trouble in a race for 15th and 16th between Danica Patrick and Brad Sweet, where Sam Hornish got involved, and now 3 cars have been wrecked.
Sunday Night Baseball on ESPN2 features the NL Central leading Cardinals as they square off against the Mets at 8. Then Monday night at 7 Eastern, the NL West leading Dodgers take on the Phillies. Both games available on ESPN3 and also live on WatchESPN.com and the Watch ESPN app. We are under caution with 64 to go at Dover. This is our 5th yellow of the day. This one because of a little contact between Sam Hornish Jr. and Danica Patrick.
A lot of contact. Hornish gets under Danica. I mean, he causes the accident. I can't wait to see what happens after this because she is little, but she is tough, and I'm sure she's going to want to whoop him after this race for record.
Getting ready to go green, AB.
63 to go.
I like that.
Kurt Busch on the move. Remember, he and Justin Allgaier, that bright orange 31 car, stopped for tires under this yellow when those in front of them did not. Free pass, by the way, for this caution. Ty Dillon in the 33, ninth place.
First, second, and third, all the Joe Gibbs Toyotas having a great day today so far. Brian Scott, a fellow we talked about a lot in our show about having some problems early this year, seems like he's having a good clean run right now.
So far.
Don't want to jinx him or nothing, but he's holding a pretty wheel, I would call it, at the moment.
That's what Leonard Wood used to say all the time, holding a pretty wheel. Teammates going at it. Like Elliott's car is a little better than it was earlier. Got that free pass and they made an adjustment. Luke Lambert, the crew chief. It's like he turned the screws in the right direction this time.
It looked like the weather a little bit, Andy. I mean, the sun's really bright earlier. Now it's a little bit overcast. The temperatures are moving around. Track temperatures are moving around. And they've had a deal with the green racetrack because of all the rain the other night after their practice session was over.
They have had to work on this 2-car for Elliott Sadler quite a bit during the course of this race. How about it, Dave?
And even when they got it better, Alan, they didn't get it far enough. He's been talking about lateral grip, needing more of that all day long. So when they had the luxury of time as the free pass recipient and time on pit road, they made a shock adjustment, clicked the shock a couple of clicks, and a wedge adjustment to try to make that car better. And so far, it has been.
Yeah, that's one thing. You know, clicking those shocks does really affect the whole personality of the car, and that's something you wouldn't normally change on a normal pit stop. But having that extra time, like Dave said, they can go in there and do something like that, and this might be a turning point for the 2-team.
Here's James Buescher challenging Justin Allgaier.
Allgaier's car just hasn't been as good. He stayed out that one time early on in the race and got that track position, at the competition caution. He was able to hold second, actually second spot till the next time he pitted, but since then his car just hasn't been there.
Now the race for position in this group is the 30 and the 88, Buescher and Witt. They're both a lap down. Buescher right now though is the first car one lap down and wants to stay there.
Oh, he's going to fight hard for that.
Get another caution, get a free pass, get back in the hunt.
You think a leader runs hard up front while he's leading the race. You ought to be a lap down and know the guy that's right behind you is a lap down. You got to race him to get back on the lead lap. And that is the hardest you will drive all day long. Because when you see an opportunity to get it back, man, that's all that's on your mind. You've got to drive really hard. Get up on a wheel, I call it.
You're always up on the wheel.
Sometimes too much.
Speaking of up on the wheel.
That's a different paint scheme I'm used to looking at in the 88 car there, Cole Witt. A little bit hard to see. But he's having a good run. I'm pretty impressed about his run today. And he's car looks like it's handling well out there. Right now he's in 11th position. He is a lap down. Race of Buescher, like we talked about, to get back that lucky dog position.
It's hard to have a hiccup like they did in qualifying and go to the back and have a good day. First off, it's hard to make your way back to the front, but also to stay out of trouble. We've seen a lot of cautions, a lot of spins and crashes, and they've been able to avoid that. See, this time, though, Ryan Truex has not let Joey Logano stretch that lead out like he has been.
Truex hometown, Mietta, New Jersey, exit 63A off the Garden State Parkway, as they refer to it. And this is the home track for the Truex clan, and boy, Ryan Truex would sure love to get a win here.
It's always been a family place. You know, there's always people out in the camper lots cooking out seafood and all this other stuff, and we go hang out with them. So it's always been a good family, you know, a good family weekend, and that just makes me want to win it even more.
Truex started on pole, and he's running second. 13 drivers have gotten their first Nationwide Series win at this track, but, Dave, it's been a while since that's happened.
Maybe I checked in under the caution with crew chief Matt Lucas and Ryan's dad, Martin Sr., who was sitting on the pit box. They've been discussing what's been going on. I said, it sounds like you tried to settle him down just a little bit, and that appears to be the case. Somewhere between shut up and drive and just get out there and race the racetrack. He's had a lot to say today about the race car, but as you guys keep pointing out, it's very fast.
All right, Dave. Well, I'll tell you also, you know, how badly the young man wants it and in limited opportunities that he gets to get behind the wheel of the car. Doesn't have a full-time ride.
Yeah, it has to turn the intensity level up by not being able to say, okay, we'll get him next week. It's this week for him.
Yeah.
Well, he can smell it right now. The last time by, he was the fastest car on the racetrack by about a half a tenth of a second. And he keeps catching Joey just a little bit. And remember,
he's going to catch him once there. Lap car.
Close.
In trouble, 24, is Tim Bainey Jr., one of the drivers making his Nationwide Series debut today. And he and the leader have tangled off of turn two.
I'm all right. He hit really hard.
In that case right there, Joey was, he was looking in the mirror. He saw that 20 car put some pressure on him. He was trying to get, needed to make that pass and get going.
Sixth caution of the race is out. Shannon?
Yeah, guys, Joey Logano, we can all agree that he's had a fast race car, but traffic has been a challenge for him the entire race. He says every time he gets in traffic and tries to pass a car, he just gets tight. They're talking about coming down pit road and trying to work on that 18 just to try to loosen him up a little bit and get him right for the end of this race.
Well, got nine cars on the lead lap, going to be a 10th with a free pass car. The 31 and 54 stopped earlier. We'll see if they call that 18 in or not.
Yeah, Joey just gets into him and spins him out.
Yeah, that kind of contact's not supposed to spin somebody out. Really kind of intended to move them.
You can tell Joey just got a little over-anxious right there.
And look who's on pit road.
Took that young man out of the race.
He's not alone. Austin Dillon coming in as well from fourth spot. So the leader, Logano, having led 148 of the 151 laps in this race so far.
Here we are.
He's going to give up that top spot for some service.
Here we are. Bring it to me.
Yeah, guys, you heard him say no mistakes. Bring that car down. They are going to just try to give him freed up just a little bit. He says no more, just a little bit on the back end and four tires for the 18. Dave.
The reason Austin Dillon wanted to pit, he thought he might have buzzed his tires when he tried to avoid what was happening all around him out there. So they came down to get four fresh and see if that'll improve his handling and speed till the end, guys.
So Joey Logano, the race leader, runs up on a slower car. And I'll say this on Logano's side, a much slower car who wasn't all the way at the bottom of the racetrack and wasn't all the way up off the bottom of the racetrack either.
I'll tell you, as a race car driver, you got a gas pedal and you got a brake pedal. You need to learn how to use both of them.
Tim Boehne Jr. in the wall and in trouble. And Ryan Truex now has the lead.
I didn't like that.
Busch 54, third place. Both looking for a way through.
Well, Elliott drove his car in really hard and the car did not stick.
Kurtz didn't stick back a two.
There he comes back. But look at Kurt drive that thing in the corner.
He's still trying to get it rolled up and turned.
Tell you, one thing I've seen all day long, guys, on a restart, if that second place car doesn't get right into turn one on that guy's bumper, that lead car checks out. You have got to be right there on these restarts. You see Brian Scott in that 11 car. He's in second right now. He got kind of way behind of Ryan Truex. Now you see these guys side by side. You see the team cars, Penske cars.
Hornish's car has damage, but it looks like it's still plenty fast. Makes the pass on Klugerman.
That is to be the first car one lap down in the event we get a caution shortly. So Hornish gets that spot for now. He's in 11th place. And by the way, following up on the earlier trouble, the 7 car was up on the jack stands in the garage being repaired, Danica Patrick, after that incident we saw earlier that Hornish was involved in. A lot of scrap parts in there, Mike.
Yeah, there's debris strewn all around this race car, Alan. Not only sheet metal, but they've torn the brake ducting out of here. I saw a broken front shock. They're doing a lot of welding on the right front right now. The steering assembly completely mangled. Still, the effort continues to try to get the 7 car back in the race. Meanwhile, Danica sits in the cockpit hoping that she'll be able to get back, but there's just 39 laps remaining.
Not the way she wanted to spend her afternoon in Dover, up on jack stands back in the garage.
Well, she needs all the experience she can get, and this is killing her right now that she can't get out there and get that valuable experience, especially at a track that's tough to drive like Dover.
Well, the two Joe Gibbs cars are two of the three out in front with Truex and Scott. Kurt Busch in third, and if he doesn't get to the front, it's not for lack of trying, because about each end of this racetrack, off of two and off of four, he's got the right side of that 54 car hung out, and he's driving it off into the corner. He's just trying to find a way to make up ground.
He's actually tried to widen the track out a little bit off of two a couple of times. We can see the right side of the car where he's made contact with the wall. He has been driving the wheels off of it, though.
And here comes Logano. Had only moved up one spot since the restart. That gets him a second. That's Logano up to fifth.
Logano's going to have another caution if he's going to get back in this.
Yes. Yes, he is. Odds of that happening?
Probably pretty good.
They're actually pretty good, yeah. 36 laps to go at the Monster Mile in Dover. Can Ryan Truex have a home track celebration? Get down to it at Dover, Delaware with an NASCAR Nationwide Series today up the highway at Englishtown, New Jersey. The Toyota NHRA Super Nationals qualifying coming up next at 4:30 Eastern on ESPN. The finals you can see over on ESPN2 tomorrow at 4:30 Eastern time. The Eyes on IndyCar Series is racing in Detroit at Belle Isle, presented by ShopAutoWeek.com. ABC tomorrow at 3:30 Eastern time. And this Nationwide Series has the weekend off next weekend. In a couple of weeks, it is the fast, emphasize capital letters, exclamation point, fast, Michigan International Speedway on ABC at 3:30 Eastern time. Over 200 miles an hour into the corner on the fresh pavement there. It's going to be something to see.
I heard some 217 miles an hour stuff getting into turn one at Michigan. That's how fast it is. New pavement really got those guys flying.
here at Dover. Been a while since a driver had scored his first Nationwide Series win on the Monster Mile, something that was a pretty frequent occurrence for many years. Can Ryan Truex join that club today? He's going to have to hold off his teammates to do it. Brian Scott is in second, and Joey Logano is in fourth, closing on Kurt Busch in third, and for the last, most of the last 10 laps has been the fastest car on the racetrack until he's caught this pack.
Yeah, but the problem he's got is he's too far behind, and those difference in lap times not enough for him to make up the ground that he's behind. I think Truex is in a good position to win this thing if it stays green. I don't think Logano can make up that ground.
Five of the last seven Dover races, last green flag run.
How long was it?
Seven laps or less.
That's not good for Truex.
But that's in five of seven. If it's the other two, then you get a long run and you celebrate.
So, Alan, you think we're going to see another caution flag, huh?
Well, odds are we will.
Well, if we don't get one, this race is going to be over in about 8 minutes. So
yes, sir.
You better not leave your couches, I can tell you that.
I think the fact that Truex is so fast at this point in the race, that's why Logano made the pit stop. I don't think Logano would have pitted had he been able to stretch it like he had been. But when he looked in his mirror and saw Truex catching him on that last run before the caution came out, I think that's what made his decision to come in and work on the car and get tired.
And it's all moot if he can't get around Kurt Busch anyway.
Andy, you work with a lot of young drivers. How nervous do you think Ryan Truex is right now?
I'd say he's pretty nervous, but he's handling it great. I mean, he's out there. He ran the second fastest lap on the track. Next to Brian Scott, actually ran the fastest.
No, he's got a run on him here. Whoa. Logano to the inside for third.
We got 22 laps to go, and I got to tell you, 22 laps here at Dover goes by awful fast.
Clear. Shut the door on him. Go get the 11. 22 to go.
And for Ryan to grab the pole position and his favorite racetrack with his entire family here, and him feeling like this is his Daytona 500, I will guarantee you, this guy is so nervous he can't see straight.
He's nervous, but he's motivated. I think he's making really good laps. He's staying very focused. How's he going to handle all these lap cars to the end of the race?
He's got to stay driving the car hard because we saw what happened to Stenhouse. And Alan, you and I had a conversation earlier about when a driver tries to slow down too much, how it alters his mindset, alters how the car handles. So my opinion is keep doing, Ryan, what you've been doing.
He's wheeling it, though. Look at that. Solid that wheel.
Busy, busy hands.
You think he's nervous? What do you think about Pop?
There's Martin Truex Sr.
I bet he's nervous.
Martin in the seafood business. Great guy to talk to. Always around the racetrack. Dave, is he going to chew that bottle?
Maybe so. I did confirm before the race, down at the car on the grid, Mr. Truex, you a little nervous about today? Oh, yeah, he said. You know, this is the baby boy, of course. Martin, older brother, has had big success, but this is younger brother, and both Dad, Martin, and Mom, Linda, are here watching this take place.
You know, earlier in the broadcast, I kept calling Ryan Martin because I'm so used to talking to Martin at the restaurant here at Dover Downs. And he's so nervous, he's trying to take a drink out of a bottle with the cap still on of it. So, you know, he's upside down right now.
Big, big deal. In this young man's career, this racetrack has meant a lot as well. Ryan, now you got me doing it. Ryan won two NASCAR K&N East Series Championships, locked them both up here at Dover. Second place, teammates. Logano 18 trying to get around Scott in the 11. And by the way, nice job by Brian Scott today in this 11 car. Nice, nice job.
Yeah, he did. He's on a very, very good race. His car's been solid under him all day.
That's exactly what you need. I mean, when you're down in the hole, you just got to have a smooth race and say, hey, I can do this. I just did it for you. Watch me.
All this going on, and even 2 seconds behind Ryan Truex. There's the leader. Here comes second. And Logano's going to have a look with some lap cars ahead.
You have a 2 second lead. The 18 has passed the 11 for second places.
Oh, boy.
A lot of yellow cars in that shot.
Yes.
And if you're Ryan, you're
his crew chief, his father, anybody like you, you're thinking, please, I don't need a caution. Please don't anybody wreck. Let this thing under green. Because, boy, if he gets a caution, this could be a whole different race.
Oh, yeah, it's going to be a different race. Logano's car is extremely fast at this point.
This is for fifth and sixth place here. Elliott Sadler giving up a spot to Justin Allgaier. Other story of the day, besides a potential first-time winner, Ricky Stenhouse Jr., involved in a crash. He was running second back at lap number 27. Lost the car off turn number two, piled into the inside wall. They spent 66 laps behind the wall getting repairs. Now the sixth car being black flagged by NASCAR for not meeting minimum speed. Right now, Stenhouse on pit road. He's 78 laps down in 32nd place. Sadler running in seventh. Each and every one of these lap cars that Ryan Truex catches now are going to make him grip that wheel a little tighter.
Oh, absolutely, Aaron. He's just track, so nervous right now. Rhythm. I want to give a shout out to Jeremy Clements, who's been on the lead lap all day long. Just got now got lapped. That 51 car, Jeremy's doing a great job today, guys.
Had a terrific run.
Yes.
A little bit of a break. They were one of the last to pit on that. Remember that cycle of green flag pit stops we had where the caution came out just after?
They played it perfectly, and they had a good enough gas mileage to make it work. You talk about Truex being nervous. He doesn't have time to be nervous. Watching that shot right there, he's busy. He is having to really wheel this thing. He's done it all day. I remember earlier in the race, he was complaining about the car being loose, and it was. We could see it, but he was running it as fast as that time as anybody.
Well, Andy, I'm never going to disagree with you, but I'm going to say he's got a little bit of space left in his brain to be nervous.
Was close.
Uh-oh. Joey says, I got to go. You saw what happened last time somebody held him up.
He got spun out, didn't he?
Nine laps to go. Can Logano chase down Truex? Will there be another caution flag?
Well, that last
Oh, hang on.
Don't give it away.
Hard to say that last time.
Loose.
He is loose.
Can't fix it now, buddy. Hold on to it.
Oh, man, he is out of control loose right now.
He's got to use that racetrack, and he's got to get up there with some more grip. If it's the top of the track, go up there
and settle the car down a bit.
And his lap times have fell off.
Here comes Logano in a hurry.
He caught him about 3/10 or more the last lap. Got to smooth it out if he's going to be able to hold him off.
Danica Patrick came out of the garage, made one slow lap on the apron, has gone back to the garage in the 7 car.
He ran almost identical times the last lap.
Can he do it?
It's going to be hard. At this point, I don't know that he's got a car that's able to run the lap times. Has to be overheating that right rear tire.
Yeah, that car is really moving around. Ryan Truex's car is, and Logano, he is just on it right now. I mean, 6 laps to go is a long way around this racetrack. As fast as Joey Logano is catching Truex.
Now he doesn't need this.
Look out. That's trouble. Wow.
Yeah, he did not
need
that.
Here comes Logano.
That killed him.
Hang on. No. New leader, Joey Logano.
Stay with him. 5 to go. Stay with him.
Ran up on 2 lap cars side by side. Had no place to go but out of the throttle.
Unbelievable.
That's how angry I am right now.
Yeah, that's a tough break right there. That's a tough way to lose that one.
And all of these slower cars. Now, let's bring back the other side of that slower car thing before that we mentioned about the Logano incident earlier. They got a responsibility to know the leaders are coming up behind them. They've got spotters on the roof of the grandstand. There's a little courtesy has to go there, doesn't it?
Well, no, I agree with you, Alan. There's no doubt about that. But if you get to a slower car, you just don't run into them. So, I mean, the slower car needs to move out of the way. But if he doesn't, you don't need to run into him and cause a big wreck. See, so, look. All these guys, they got to respect each other, or else they're going to have problems.
Here's third place, Brian Scott, trying to hang on and make it a Joe Gibbs Racing 1-2-3 sweep. Kurt Busch pressing him hard.
Well, you got to feel bad for Ryan Truex. I would have bet anything I had he was going to win this race. Joey Logano was so far behind Ryan Truex at one point.
Well, I think one thing is it's hard not for Ryan Truex not to overdrive the car. He has a loose car, and he's overdriving it a little bit because he knows this 18's coming, which doesn't do anything but aggravate his problem of being loose. And then the terrible break of catching those lap cars.
One lap to go.
Bring it home, bud. Bring it home.
There's your stories of the day summed up in that one camera shot. The six all beaten up and off the pace, and the 18 out front leading. For Joey Logano, he's going to have led 154 of 200 laps. He's going to pick up another win at Dover. And Joe Gibbs Racing gets a 1-2-3 sweep. Logano wins it. Truex second. Brian Scott third.
It's all time, buddy. It's about time we won here.
Well, Joey Logano
said. Good car, by the way.
You think? Joey Logano said this was a great racetrack. He loves this place.
But he really loves it.
He hadn't won at Dover yet.
Monster, baby!
He's happy now.
Yeah, I think so. That was a great drive.
And on the other side of that coin, heartbroken for the moment. Ryan Truex. Don't get down.
No, he drove a good race, too.
Your time's coming. Well, Shannon, it looked bleak for a bit, but they're going to celebrate this 18 team.
They sure are, Adam Stevens. I just heard you say, golly. What was it like watching your driver come from 7th to 1st in just over 40 laps here at Dover?
It was gut-wrenching, to be honest. I really expected more guys to come down pit road. We got boxed in a little bit on the restart, and Truex, I tell you, why he doesn't have a full-time ride, I'll never know. Him and that Grindstop team and that 20 car were amazing all weekend. I'm proud of that kid. I'm proud of the job he's done every time he's gotten one of our cars. But, you know, the Dollar General Toyota, we were the heat all day. And Joey, he's the master of this place. And just to come here and race with the cars prepared by Doug and Reggie and the guys at the shop, it's a privilege, and I enjoy it every week.
No doubt, great day for Joe Gibbs Racing. Guys?
Well, Joey Logano celebrating his first win at Dover and his fourth nationwide series win of 2012. We'll talk with he, some of the other top finishers in a minute. The 5-Hour Energy 200 in the books for the NASCAR Nationwide Series at the Monster Mile. And a look at how it all turned out. Joey Logano with his fourth win of the year.
He got it done. No doubt he had the fastest car throughout the day. Really feeling really bad for Ryan Truex. I thought the kid had it won.
Yeah, how about Ty Dillon? Top 10, first time out.
So a look at the top 10 finishers there. We'll call this next bit the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. We'll start with the victory part.
Seems like just yesterday an 18-year-old Joey Logano was making his very first nationwide start right here at Dover, and now you're in victory lane. I gotta ask you about that last run. I know you were really quiet on the radio. If we would have looked inside that car, what would we have seen you doing?
It was a pretty intense moment in there trying to catch Ryan. We came in, took four, and I was like, oh no man, we just gave another one away here at Dover. But Adam Stevens and the guys gave me one heck of a Dollar General car that can work my way back up there, and was running hard but was somewhat patient with it. And Ryan got caught up with the lap traffic or whatever, and I had a big run and I got on the outside. He got really loose there at the end of the run. So got to thank Dollar General, GameStop, Sport Clips, you know, Nationwide. Dollar General on Monday, you can go 20% off orders online, so for the win here, so that's something really cool too. So excited about this win here. It's been a long time coming. I feel like I've lost a lot of them here and been really close to winning them and never been able to win it. So to finally get it, it just means a lot.
You had to come down pit road. You had to restart 7th. It was because of the contact with the 24. It happened right after that. What happened there?
Lap car is just not giving enough room to the leaders, not enough respect to the leaders out there. When you're trying to race for the lead, and the 20 was faster than me at that time, he was catching me, and you don't have no time to waste. And got underneath him in the center of the turn, and he just kept coming down. So not much we can do there, but either way, we're back here in victory lane.
Enjoy this one, Joey. Joey Logano in victory lane here at Dover. Dave?
Well, Shannon, it's a very delicate thing to try to console a racer who has just lost what was seemingly won. Anybody made you feel better yet? You had a lot of family down here.
Not really. And it's just frustrating, but it's a good day for Joe Gibbs Racing. 1-2-3, right? 1-2-3? Yeah, that's good. You know, Dollar General, Grind Boss, Toyota, everyone that puts this team together, you know, there's a reason why Joe Gibbs won this race today. All three cars in the top three, they're just the best team out here, and I'm fortunate to be able to be on this team. You know, I wish it was more than 7 times a year, but hopefully we can do more. And just want to thank Grind Boss, Toyota, Nationwide Insurance, everybody. I'll get one eventually. It's just tough.
Describe approaching that lap traffic, Ryan. What was going through your mind, and maybe what should have happened differently?
Well, I figured they'd both go outside because they're about 20 laps down each, 3 seconds slower. I don't know if they had spotters or not, but to race each other in front of the leader like that, it's just not smart. But I don't want to put anyone down, name any names or any of that nonsense. Probably could have picked a better way to get around them. And when Joey got outside me there, 3 and 4, I just got loose. I almost wrecked it, but that run there, we'd been looser than we had been. And we were definitely running out of time. I think if I wouldn't have caught that lap traffic, we would have had him. But he had the better car, better tires. So congratulations to him. Like I said, good day for Joe Gibbs Racing.
Speed and skill, but today was not Ryan Truex's day. Alan?
Well, like I said before, hang in there. You'll get one.
Yeah, he did a good job with that. I tell you, those lap cars could have given him a lot more respect, especially in that situation. That late in the race for those two lap cars to decide that is really heartbreaking, I'm sure.
Terrific drive, though, by Ryan Truex to finish second today behind Joey Logano, who scored his 4th win of the year. We have more post-race coverage from the Monster Mile on the way. Logano celebrating a win. As the fans file out, say hello to Miles the Monster. We look ahead for the NASCAR Nationwide Series. Next race, 2 weeks from today, on the extremely fast, recently resurfaced Michigan International Speedway. Then the road course at Road America, the mile and a half in Kentucky, and Daytona for halfway through the season. Join us at the track, NASCAR.com/tickets, or the number at the bottom of the screen. As the race was still finishing up, Danica Patrick retired her car for the day, and Mike caught up with her then.
And obviously a very disappointed Danica Patrick. Danica, close quarters racing there with Sam Hornish. What happened?
I don't know. I have to see the replay to know for sure. But, you know, we were all going gangbusters on the restart. The tires are so good, so you try and use them. And I was racing the car in front of me, and, you know, the car behind me is racing me. So I'd have to see it to know. But more than anything, it was just kind of a bummer because I was just starting to get into the rhythm, I think. I struggled a lot at the beginning. The slower you go, the looser it is because the car is up and off the track. So once I finally just stopped using the brakes so much, I got going a little bit faster. But it's just a bummer for the team. You know, I always hate to see them in the garage working their butts off like that. So I hate those fire drills. But and a bummer for GoDaddy. Would have liked to have got a nice result for them here. It was a bummer last time, but at least it wasn't a blown right front. So we'll learn from this and we'll come back better.
Thanks for your time.
Yeah, thanks.
A tough ending to an otherwise promising day for Danica Patrick.
All right, Mike Patrick will finish in 30th position on the day while Joey Logano shares a little moment. Family moment. Yeah, that's 4 this year for Joey. Showing he can get it done behind the wheel here at Dover.